and publications organized by Department of Commerce, School of Business Management and Legal Studies, University of Kerala. Let's resume our conference and I welcome you all to track B. Today, we have two chairs with us in this track, Dr. P. N. Harikumar and CMA Dr. Kinnari V. Thakur.
I'm taking this opportunity to welcome one of the most eminent personalities, Dr. P. N. Harikumar, Professor, Department of Commerce, University of Kerala. He has 25 years of teaching experience and has obtained dual PhD from the University of Kerala in both commerce and management. His enthusiasm in research has been widely accepted. 16 PhDs were awarded under him, and 4 of them have been submitted, which are awaiting its report. He has published 54 books in commerce and management and has 160 publications. He has attended research methodology and data analysis workshops in 32 institutes, which includes IIMs, International Business Schools, and also ICFI Hyderabad, Punjab Technical University, Tata Institute of Social Science. He has organized more than 80 research methodology workshops in the national level and has international conference in 14 countries. He is a member of the Board of Studies in 4 universities in the state of Kerala.
Next, on chair 2, we have with us CMA Dr. Kinnari V. Thakur, Professor and Head, Department of Commerce, University of Mumbai. We are so lucky to have her here today, as she is a highly talented person with 22 years of teaching experience. She has received various awards, including Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Award for Teaching Excellence in 2018. She co-authored 6 books in the field of accountancy and finance, and organized several international conferences, faculty development programs, webinars, and workshops. Moreover, she has published 42 research papers in various national and international research journals. Her qualifications and experiences are beyond what words can describe.
Once again, on behalf of the Department of Commerce, all heartily we welcome the two chairs of the session, Dr. P. N. Harikumar and CMA Dr. Kinnari V. Thakur. Over to the chairs for comments.
Respected dignitaries and other professors, participants, research scholars, and my dear students. This is a prestigious program organized by our Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, International Conference relating to a finance area. Totally different concepts, financial research. Lecturings were over, and today the International Conference Track B will start right now. And in this occasion, I extend my sincere welcome to the great personality, Dr. Kinnari. Once again, I welcome you. And in the track B, we have 10 presentations, different topic area of this. And the presenters are directed to present the abstract of paper within 10 minutes. You will take only a maximum of 10 minutes. And after 3 minutes discussion and any queries raised by the audiences.
Hari sir, your mic is mute, sir.
So Hari Kumar sir, your mic is muted. Yes, so please unmute your mic.
Okay. The most centuries of this program, my beloved head of the department, CMM, and my beloved Dr. Simon Tuttle, sir, Viju AV, Viju T, and Vinu, other participants. This is a prestigious program of our Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, because the area of research is related to finance. The different concepts relating to financial research and the discussion is over for over the last 1 week. And here, today we organize an international conference relating to finance research. And the track B, the paper presentation will start now. And we have with us an eminent personality, Dr. Kinnari. She is also chair of this session. And in this section, track B, we have 10 paper presentations. And we direct all the paper presenters to present their abstract of the thesis or abstract of the paper for a maximum of 10 minutes. And after that, 3 minutes discussion. And if the audience have any queries to ask, you can raise it. So this is a modus operandi of the presentations in track B. So in this occasion, once again, I welcome Dr. Kinnari for chairing the technical session of track B. And I invite...
Thank you, sir.
I invite Kinnari, Dr. Kinnari, to say a few words as an introduction in track B. Madam, please come.
Yes. Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Audible. Perfect.
Yes. So good afternoon to all the respected members of the Department of Commerce, Kerala University, and dear participants. So you all are aware that this conference, you will have to present your papers. And as sir said, that you will have to take 10 minutes for presentation. So I'll request that all the participants who are presenting papers should speak on what new concepts and novel ideas they have come forth with for their research papers. So focus mainly on your objectives, on your research methodology, and the final conclusion which you have derived from the research work. And it will really help you. And also listen to the other participants. I like to say that because some papers are very, very good, and most of them, if you get an idea from others' work, you start doing your review of literature by this stage only, that you get an idea from others' work that what new topics or what new areas you can identify for your research work. So you may be... listening to other participants also will really help you in gathering novel ideas for your research work, so which you can take it forward for your another programs wherein you are planning to present papers or maybe write research articles. So thank you, the Department of Commerce, Kerala University, for giving me an opportunity to chair the session. And let the students start, because we have already running behind this schedule, and that is almost 1:30. We have just it will start. So best is that we can start right now.
So here I invite Anne Susan Thomas and Teresa Mary Reggie for presentation. The title of the paper is Engineering a Sustainable Financial Architecture in India. Please present. And Susan Thomas, are you ready?
Hello.
Oh, yes.
Hello, sir. Is the presentation being shared?
Yes, it is. It is visible. And
okay. Okay, so actually Teresa is starting it. So she will be beginning the presentation.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yes.
You are Teresa.
Okay, thank you. A very warm good afternoon to one and all present here. Respected dignitaries, me, Teresa and Mary Reggie, and my partner Anne Susan Thomas are here to present our topic, Engineering a Sustainable Financial Architecture in India, the Green Bond Market. We are starting with our introduction. India is susceptible to deepening climate changes and impending pandemics. India is one of the most climate vulnerable countries in the world and is ranked 5th in the Global Climate Risk Index. Even the COVID-19 pandemic has accentuated the complexity and interconnectedness of our world in terms of trade, commerce, as well as the relationship between the people and the society, and how quickly these links can collapse if not sustainable. It is thus vital that economic stimulus measures are cognizant of long-term sustainable and inclusive solutions that put us on a sustainable recovery pathway. The idea of sustainable finance has moved from a niche market to one that is increasingly mainstream. Debt capital markets are crucial sources of long-term funding to help close financing gaps and mobilize capital for sustainable development. Global and the Indian green bond market has the ability and potential to mobilize capital for projects with environmental benefits. So now we are moving to our statement of the problem. India is ranked 5th most vulnerable nation to the effects of climate change with 2.5 to 4.5% of its GDP at risk. And the researchers form sufficiently enough ground as to why our development trajectory should be altered towards a sustainable pathway, which has a tri-directional change in the financial sector's thought process on sustainable lending and investing. And the pandemic has accentuated the complexity and interconnectedness of our world and how quickly these links can collapse if not sustainable. If not in position to address climate mitigation globally and meet adaptation goals in emerging markets, which are more climate-ready. Here arises our statement of the problem, and it is the need for intelligence into the sphere of green bonds, which has become more crucial nowadays. Now, the review of literature. Ravatha, in his study, has explained about the sustainable development, and Schoenmaker and Shramir has explained the importance of finance in allocating investment to the sustainable companies, and the explanation about the corporate green bonds are given by Chen, Lonu, and Serafin. And our objectives of the study are to understand the current framework of the green bond market prevalent in India, to review the policy framework prevailing in the country, and to probe into the challenges as well as the potential green finance strategies to be undertaken. And the methodology. Our study is descriptive in nature, and the secondary information is compiled and gathered from several sources like the national and regional studies, working papers, and also formal publications on international platforms. Now over to you, Anne.
Okay, so now we are moving on to an explanation towards the objectives. About the green bond market globally, basically green bonds, as we all know, are fixed income instruments whose proceeds are earmarked exclusively for new and existing projects with environmental benefits focused on renewables, energy efficiency, water, clean transport, climate change mitigation and adaptation. The rapid growth of the global green bond market over the past decade has moved to more than $700 billion in outstanding issues. In 2019, actually, there was an outperformance, and India had become the second largest market globally for green bonds with $10.3 billion worth of transactions. Even after an initial slowdown during the pandemic, it rebounded, I think, almost by the third quarter, reaching a record high of again $69.5 billion by the end of 2020. Now, to understand the green bond market scenario in India, the first issuance of green bonds was made by the Yes Bank in 2015. Then in 2016, the Axis Bank made its green bond issue internationally. Then again, coming to its current stage, its current outstanding amount is about $16.3 billion. So all this shows that from the time India had started moving on to or coming to the green bond market, they have shown a consistent effort towards its exponential growth, or there has always been an exponential growth. The top green bond issuers as of now is the SBI, Renew Power, Azure Power Limited, Adani Green Energy, where they all finance as well as they issue bonds and use this money for solar power plants or windmills or renewable energy projects. Although the value of green bonds issued in India since 2018 constitutes only a very small portion of the total bond issuance, it maintains a favorable position as compared to the other emerging economies. Moving on to the prevailing policy framework of the Indian government, it is among one of the economies that does have their own set of guidelines other than the internationally accepted ones in terms of green bond issuance. And as we see in 2007, we started emphasizing on their concept of green finance. By 2008, we had the NAPCC formed for mitigating the impact of climate change. In 2011 came the Climate Change Finance Unit. Then again in 2012, the need for publishing the annual business responsibility reports had come up. And in 2016, the amount of companies who are into it are about 1,000. In May 2017 was when SEBI actually issued clear guidelines for green bond issuance, specifying the disclosure requirements, giving a more clarity towards this subject. So, on studying and knowing about the conditions of the green bond markets in India as well as globally, the challenges that we found that have to be encountered are identifying, measuring, and tracking green investment requires the use and analysis of data that are not readily available or standardized in many markets. There is still an insufficiency in the amount of data or the reporting facility that is always still in the nascent stage. Then again, the limited availability of assets that are labeled green. I mean, it is still, though we have definitions and government policies regarding, to give clarity on the subject, there is limited availability of such assets as well as standards for identifying how these assets and projects are green. Next is understanding how to meet the criteria for a green label. That is both for the issuers and investors. There is much more awareness needed, and there is more need of developing measurement and disclosure tools. Then again, the sustainable finance policies and regulatory framework. That is, a stable macroeconomic and policy environment are still needed to encourage capital flow to green projects, especially in the case where we have deficiencies in addressing green finance definitions, data, and reporting. And finally, and one of the main is the underdeveloped capital markets with insufficient liquidity and high transaction costs. So when it comes to our green bond market or our bond market infrastructure as such, we have deficiencies in, there must be more clarity in exchange and trading platforms, clearing houses, the credit risk assessment and such issues. And these all have yet to be addressed so as to make the green bond atmosphere much more accessible and easier one. So moving on to the conclusions or suggestions, what we came up with is India is currently has an environmental upper hand in two senses. That is, one is the global world being dependent on our climate choices, as we are the world's largest climate mitigation opportunity, because about 1/3 of the emissions come from our country, and which is why all the other countries are naturally dependent on India. Again, the sustainable development goals which have been maintained also again depends more on our country. That means unless we achieve these, or unless we make sure that our environment is good, then only can all the other countries as well as environments depending on us can move in the same way. So what this gives us is an upper hand or a leverage over other countries. And the thing what we have to look into it is maybe how do we use this leverage to make more finances, to get in more international investments. So that was what we meant through the first point, or that is something we have to more ponder into. then our suggestions may be like we need more of institutional arrangements for green bond management, more standards regarding minimum size of green bond issuance, controllable transaction and borrowing costs. And again, another strategy which we heard from various excerpts is the decentralizing of such issuances. Rather than it being concentrating in this as a central issue, it can be decentralized more into municipal bonds and such. And thus, it will become more accessible and more towards the common people. Then again, our portfolio of green must be more enhanced, not just renewable financing, but also to energy financing or water efficiency and such other spheres. Now it's just onto maybe solar plants or windmills, some only the basic renewables. And there is, I mean, a scope to move into more than that. Again, even when doing all this, the human resources who deal in such companies or deal with such projects must always realize all the sustainability or green objectives in pricing through a risk lens. Unless we realize the risk, we're not going to go through it, and we would just not continue with the area or the project. So this is what we came up with our small research on this area. And these were the references, and that's it with our topic. Thank you so much.
Okay, I'm Susan Thomas and Teresa Mary Reggie. It's a wonderful presentation, but I have one doubt. What are the guidelines given by the SEB for issue of green bonds? You got the idea?
Hello. Sir, yes, sir. The guidelines were more on what constitutes green, on what makes bond green, like on what all investments or projects when you issue, or I mean projects when you invest, is the bond named green? That means it may be renewable, climate, or water. I mean, they gave the specifics for what constitutes in it. That was the main thing. Then other one is disclosure regarding when it must be reported, which is not being done actually. The proper reporting or the annual reporting, how much times must the board of meeting come together regarding this. These were what were given in the 2017 SEBI report.
Okay, madam. Okay. So, Kinnari, madam, please. Kinnari, madam. Hello, Kinnari ma'am. So any other question from the audience? Participants, you are directed to ask questions. Please.
Kinnari ma'am, are you there?
Kinnari ma'am?
So I think there is a technical problem with her.
Maybe. So yeah. Any other question from other participants? Please ask. Shall I move on to rest of presentations?
Yes, sir. We can move on to next presentation. Kinnari ma'am will join by the time.
Okay. So the next paper titled Farmers Perception Towards Various Agricultural Financing Schemes, a case study of Gujarat. Paper presented by Dr. Ankita Srivastava and Gurvinder Kaur Pandit, Dandayal Energy University.
Good afternoon, sir. Are we audible?
Yes, audible.
Yeah. Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. And first of all, I would like to say thank you so much, Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, for giving us this opportunity to present our views on the topic Farmers' Perception Towards Various Agri-Financing Schemes, a Case Study of Gujarat. Me, along with my...
Am I audible now? Just tell me.
Yeah. Kinnari ma'am, we can hear you.
Yes, fine.
Yeah. Should I go ahead, ma'am?
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay. So I, Dr. Ankita Srivastava, along with my colleague, Ms. Gurvinder Kaur, we both are assistant professor in University, Pandit Deen Dayal Energy University, Gujarat. We are going to present our views on this topic. As we know, agriculture in India is livelihood for a majority of the population and can never be underestimated. Although the contribution of agriculture in the gross domestic product today, if we see GDP, has reduced to less than 20%, that is somewhere 19.9% at present. We are sharing the PPT, sir. Is this visible?
No.
Is this not visible?
Okay, I'm sharing again.
Meanwhile, we apologize for not switching on our cameras because we have logged in from desktop and we are not having the webcam. So just excuses, please.
No problem. You just share your video. That's all.
Yeah, we are just sharing the
PPT on screen.
Okay,
Ankita, I'm sharing.
I will do it. Just a moment. I'm just doing it. Net is little slow. Please bear with us. I'm just trying to do it.
Hello?
Yeah, I'm sharing it. I'm sharing it. I'm sharing it.
Okay,
is this visible?
Visible.
Yeah, it's visible.
Visible.
Okay. I'll just... I'm changing the slides. Is this visible? I hope it is visible.
It's visible. You can continue.
Yeah. Okay. So, as I told you that agriculture in India is the livelihood of majority. And if we see agricultural finance is needed to meet various demands like need for good quality seeds, supply of power, procurement of fertilizers, agricultural marketing, post-harvesting storage, even for transport purpose also. And to meet all such things, meeting the risk like damage due to pest, disease, and issues like rainfall, etc., the agri-finance things are needed. India has both institutional and non-institutional means.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Sorry to interrupt. Please change your slides.
The slide which you can see on your screen is the objective slide. Okay, I was ma'am. Just giving the background and I'll just come on this objective very soon.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. So in India, we have both kind of finances schemes which is available to farmers, like institutional schemes and non-institutional schemes. So our objective for this particular study is to evaluate the farmers' opinion towards various agricultural financing schemes which is available to them, and also to assess the growth and challenges in agri-financing in India. The demographic profile of respondents, which we had chosen, we have taken a sample of 200 farmers. We have collected data. This is the demographic profile of the respondents. We have used the structured questionnaire to ask the question to interview the farmers. And methodology, if I talk about, we have taken 200 farmers as a sample and we have used structured questionnaire for collecting the data. The sampling technique which we have used is the non-probability sampling technique, and it was a convenient sampling. Rather, I would say that we had first selected, based on the secondary data, we had first selected the districts. So we had selected two districts of Gujarat, that is Sabarkantha and Mehsana. And in Sabarkantha also, we had seen that those areas which were using such schemes more. So we had selected Talod district, and in Talod district, the data has been taken from Kher Brahma village in Sabarkantha district, and for Mehsana we had selected Visnagar Taluka, and the data has been collected from Becharpura village. The method, the research methods which we have used is the descriptive method, and we have used inferential analysis. The analytical tools which we have applied in this particular study is ANOVA. Also, we had started the study with research question that is there any significant difference in farmers' opinion towards various types of agricultural loan schemes which is available to them and their educational level. Also, is there any significant difference in farmers' opinion towards loan for purchasing a new land if they want, and their educational level, along with the research question, that is third research questions, is there any significant difference in farmers' opinion towards credit policy and their educational level. The further part will be presented by my colleague, Ms. Gurvinder Kaur. Gurvinder ma'am, over to you.
Okay, good afternoon everyone. So apart from these research questions, we have put 12, we have tested 12 research questions, but due to this like time limit, we have only put 3 research questions in this PPT. So for by descriptive analysis, firstly what we have tried to done, we have asked farmers from which type of financial sources they are using to meet their agriculture expenses. So most of them, like 82.5% of them, said they are using their own money, and 72% has told they are using they are borrowing the money from institutional sources, and 46% are using borrowing their loans from the non-institutional sources. So why this own money is 82.5%? It means some of the farmers are using own money as well as some money from the institutional sources. Similarly, some farmers are borrowing the money from institutional sources as well as from the non-institutional sources. So to try to understand from which sources they are getting this, they are borrowing this money, we have made this bar diagram. Then we have also asked questions like why they are using their own money, why they are mainly dependent on their own money for their agriculture expenses. So one of the reason is most of the farmers are some secondary source of income. Second reason why they are borrowing the money from this, why they are using their own money for the agriculture expenses, they have this fear like they will not be able to repay the loans at time. Then we have also asked questions like from which type of institutions they are getting these loans. So most of them are getting loans from cooperative societies, which are, these are the small type of bank which is there into the village. So it is easy for farmers to borrow money from these type of societies. Then second bank from there which they are getting these loans is national banks. Then we try to find out like what is the reason why they are going for this institutional sources. So most of the farmers said because the when they are getting loans from banks, etc., regional rural banks or cooperative banks, the rate of interest is really reasonable, and the availability of these institutes nearby their villages, these are the two main reasons why they are borrowing the money from the institutional sources. Then we have also asked like which type of non-institutional sources they are using to borrow the money. So most of them are relying on the borrowing the money from relatives and friends. And secondly, they are dependent on private money lenders. So then we try to find out what is the reason why they are borrowing the money from non-institutional sources. So most of people said that to meet their immediate needs, like in case of emergency, if they need money, they go for non-institutional sources. Secondly, the lower rate of interest. And this low rate of interest may be because most of the farmers are dependent, getting this money, borrowing the money from the relatives and friends. That's why maybe they are getting it at a low rate of interest. And then there is less inconvenience in getting these type of loans. Like there's less paperwork and less time required to get these loans. Then we try to analyze on the basis of the amount of money which they are borrowing from different sources or the expenses for agricultural activities, from where they are getting the money. So we divided it according to the money requirement. Below 50,000, the farmers are mostly meeting their money needs from their own money. And as long as this amount is increasing between 50,000 to 1 lakh, most of them are dependent on institutional type of sources. Similar is the case for 1 lakh to 1.5 lakh rupees of money. If they need for the agricultural expenses, they go for institutional sources. And above 1.5 lakh, they are going for their most part of the expenses, they are doing from their own money. So maybe these are the farmers who are big farmers who can, who have a lot of their own money. They have some secondary sources. That's why they are picking this option. So then we try to find out what are the constraints why farmers are not taking the loans from the institutional sources. So first reason, to our surprise, like they said, there is high rate of interest. Second reason why they are not taking loans from the institutional sources, like loan sanctioning takes a lot of time. Third reason is there is lack of guidance. Fourth reason is inappropriate behavior by the banker. Then sometimes they are finding from institutional type of sources because there are a lot of inconvenience and formalities. That's why they are not getting they are not getting sufficient amount of loans from institutional sources. Then we also ask farmers like which type of financial schemes they are using, and most of them are using the financial schemes related to crop loan. And second scheme which they are using is Kisan Credit Card. Then third, they are using the schemes which are related to irrigation. And fourth one is related to insurance. Then we rank these schemes as per the opinions given by the farmers, which are the factors which are determining factors for choice of a particular financial scheme by the government. So first factor which is determining their choice is availability of the schemes. Like if people are aware about these schemes. Second reason is low rate of interest. If rate of interest will be low, they will go for that scheme. Third reason is if the time to sanction the loan is very low, then they go for that scheme. Fourth is like if the place from there where they can get this loan is nearby their village. That is the fourth reason. Similarly, we try to find that why farmers are not paying their loans on time. So first reason in this case is crop failure. Second reason is bad monsoon. Third reason is insufficient supply of appropriate fertilizer, seeds and pesticides on time. That is the reason why they cannot get the proper output from the cultivation, and they cannot pay the loans on time. Fourth reason is sometimes there is some emergency expenses in the family. Fifth reason is the low crop price. So then we also try to find out that is the, farmers' perception is changing with their different education level. So we asked around 26 questions in this questionnaire, the various farmers' perceptions about various type of agricultural loan schemes are satisfactory. Kisan credit card using is very easy. So crop loan is enough for agriculture expenses, and irrigation schemes are increasing their production. So we have asked these type of questions, and then we try to find the difference between the opinion of different farmers on the basis of their education level. And we have found that only we get significant result for this credit policy only up to small farmers. So for this question, we have got the significant results. For rest, the null hypothesis was accepted. So now coming to the conclusions, we can conclude that why farmers are using different sources of financing, like why they are using their own fund for agriculture expenses. Main reason is because they have a secondary income from other sources. And the reason why they're using institutional sources is the low rate of interest. And for non-institutional sources, they go for only in case of emergency. And as we know, as we have seen, most of the farmers has opted this crop loan scheme. So what is the reason why farmers has given more preference to this scheme? Because of easy availability of money by this scheme. Then low rate of interest on the loans under this scheme. And they get sufficient amount of time for the repayment. Then why farmers are not availing the agri financing schemes properly? The reasons are it takes long time in the processing, and the loan sanction takes a lot of time. Second, there is lack of guidance to the farmers, like which type of schemes are there for them. And thirdly, they're finding they're not getting sufficient amount of loans from the institutional sources. So maybe the reason is that for a given collateral, the banks are not giving them sufficient amount of the loans. So these are the main reasons why they are not going for agriculture. They are not opting agriculture financing schemes to bear their agriculture expenses. So thank you. So if there is any question.
Madam, this is a very good paper, but you mentioned the reason for not availing agricultural financing scheme by the farmers, long processing time, lack of data and insufficient fund availability. So my question, what are your practical suggestions for availing such agriculture financing scheme by the farmers?
Sir, processing, when farmers are trying to get loans from the banks, there should be transparency. So some of the managers are very, if the farmer want to get a loan, the managers might bribe from farmers. So there should be some transparency. Monitoring of these schemes should be tight. Like there should be transparency, as well as there should be some clear rules. And the processing time should be decreased. Through the schemes, banks can the awareness awareness about these schemes can be increased, so that people will know from which bank they can get the loan at a lower rate of interest. As in our data, we have found that most of the farmers are not using the loans from the cooperative banks. And as we know from the secondary level data, the rate of interest is very low in these banks, 4%. So there may be lack of, and most of the farmers are relying on the loans, which they are borrowing from the cooperative societies. And as we know, cooperative societies doesn't have a sufficient amount of funds. So maybe due to that, they are not, they are finding it like insufficient amount of funds are available. They are unaware about other options like regional rural banks or cooperative banks, which can give them loans at a low rate of interest. And the formalities are also very less. Paperwork is also very less in when the farmers go to take loans from these banks. So we can aware about this scheme. So just by awareness, I think it can be
increased.
As schemes may be very useful for the farmers.
Okay, madam, this is a very good paper, because the topic is good. The identification of variables are wonderful. So thank you, madam.
Thank you, madam.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you start asking.
Yes, sir. So, madam, what was the sample which you have collected?
Ma'am, sample size was 200.
And what is the population? So, on the basis of any idea about what is the population?
Yeah, in Sabarkantha district, the Kher Brahma village was having a population of 4,500 plus people. And in Mehsana district, which we have selected, the Becharpura village was having 1,600 plus population, ma'am.
No, population of farmers, not the population of this place. Only the farmers I'm asking, because that whether the sample is enough to draw conclusions for the populations, that is just I wanted to confirm. So population of the farmers of that area where you have collected this information of your research work, from where you have collected this information.
So, ma'am, when we say about Sabarkantha, there was mainly 9 talukas. So, you want me to tell you about Talot taluka population?
Your study is on which area, which geographical area?
It is from Kher Brahma.
So, in Kher Brahma, how many total farmers are there, and out of which how many?
4,500 plus farmers were there in Kher Brahma.
Okay.
So, plus in Becharpura, it was 1,600 plus. So
have you included Becharpura in your study?
Actually, we have used this rule of thumb. We take 1/3 of population of the farmers. We have taken.
But is that conclusion enough to give the conclusions drawn are enough to justify your population? Because only 200 farmers may say that on institute. Because now, if you see, the government is giving farmers special loan facility and loan within short time, you know. So are these facilities not availed by the farmers in that Sabarkantha area?
Ma'am, we are trying, we will, you are right, we also thought that this much sample is not sufficient. So we are again planning to increase the sample size. So maybe this time, I think if we go by the statistical methods to measure which sample size we should pick, it should be around the 450. So we are planning to add some more farmers, and then we are also going to do this efficiency analysis, like how microfinance institutes are working, their productivity, their efficiency. So we are also we will also do the study from bank's point of view. So are they working perfectly, like efficiently, or like for this we will use this DA technique or SFA. So at that time we will add some more sample.
Fair enough. Done.
Can I ask?
Yes, please.
Yeah, madam, this is not a question. It's actually a suggestion, because if you see your topic title and the way you come out with the result, it is if it is a 10-month year old, it is fine. But currently we are living in a different world, and the problems faced by the agriculture is different. It would be great if you choose a particular area like Kisan credit card or crop loan. Or are the farmers are using, why you said already the farmers are using 89% on fund, they are not going for the financing because of the high risk, right? Either then the mitigation of this is that as farmers are doing, is there any crop insurance? Is there any other parameters the farmers are using? Is there any price risk management tool they use? Is there the future market or anything? If the country like Gujarat is having the farmers, and we are projecting everywhere the development in the Gujarat. So as per your paper, it is we are still behind, you know. We need to see more focused area. It is a policy decision. So you have to focus on, rather than giving into a big title, to focus on a certain segment of either crop loan or credit card, Kisan credit card, or contract farming. So these areas need to be focused more, that is more relevant to the current situation.
Okay, sir. We will definitely.
This is only a suggestion.
Thank you so much, sir.
So, okay.
Any other questions? Hello, are we audible?
Yeah, we can go to the next presenter.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
To move forward to the next presentation.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Please, the host, please read out the next presenter.
Next, I invite Ms. Gitika Gera, Aurora Assistant Professor of Chandigarh University, to present her presentation on the title Basel III Norms and Capital Adequacy, Review of Recent Studies at National and International Level.
Okay, madam. Start presentation.
I request all the presenters to please stick on time of 10 minutes.
Good afternoon to one and all present over here. Is my presentation is visible to you all?
No, not yet. Can you share it again?
Okay. Is this visible?
Yeah, now it is visible.
Okay. A very good afternoon to one and all present over here, the respected chairpersons and all the members of Kerala University, as well as all my colleague participants. This is Kritika Gera Arora, and today I will be going to present the topic, that is Basel III norms and capital adequacy. This is the review of recent studies at national and international level. This is my review paper. For this paper, I have reviewed around 40 papers, from which I have made certain findings. So I will be discussing everything in this presentation, starting with the introductory part, that is I'm starting with the introduction to BIS, that is a Bank for International Settlement. It was established on 17 May 1930. It is the oldest international financial institution which provides a platform for consultative cooperation among the central banks. But now the role of BIS has undergone change as per the needs of the international financial sector. And now it acts as an institution for collection, compilation and dissemination of economic and financial statistics. So why I have been giving you the introduction of BIS, because for the whole paper, that is the paper of review of Basel norms, BCBS is simply the Basel Committee of Banking Supervision. It is a part of BIS structure only, and it was formed at the end of 1974 by governors of G10 nations. At today's time, there are total 13 nations which are a part of this this structure, and the BCBS issued a series of documents beginning in 1975 on banking supervision. So that is the reason I have started this with the introduction to BIS only. Next is why there is a need of adequate capital. Nearly all jurisdictions with active banking markets, they require banks to maintain a minimum level of capital. Capital plays an important role in any business, but it is critically important in the case of banks, as it serves as a foundation for a bank's future growth and a cushion against its unexpected losses. So adequately capitalized banks as well as well-managed banks, they are better able to withstand losses and to provide credit to consumers and businesses as well. And thus, one can say that capital is one of the key determinant and indicator of the soundness of bank, not only because adequate capital serves as a safety net, but also it is the ultimate determinant of bank lending and investment capacity. Next is why we need adequate capital, or what is the meaning of capital adequacy. Capital adequacy is a core of supervisory activities all over the world, and it is the important benchmark of the soundness of financial institutions. But it is gaining prominence after the recent credit crunch of 2008, which saw numerous financial institutions collapsing because their capital was not big enough to absorb the risk they are taking. That is the reason I have chosen this topic of capital adequacy, because Basel committee has given different norms, starting from Basel 1 norm, Basel 2 and Basel 3. But still, after 2008 crunch, all these norms were inefficient, and there are numerous banks that have been collapsed after the crunch of 2008. Starting with the history of Basel Accord, talking about the Basel I, the capital adequacy framework, which was given by Basel Committee on Banking Supervision in 1988. Basically, Basel Accord is a capital adequacy framework which is being developed by Basel Committee in 1988 only. BCBS decided to introduce a capital measurement system, commonly referred to as Basel Capital Accord. This is to provide for the implementation of a credit risk measurement framework with a minimum capital standard of 8% by the end of 1992, which is known as a Basel I. So under Basel I Accord, the main focus was on credit risk only. And according to the Basel I, what was a requirement, or what was a suggestion given by Basel Committee, that every bank has to maintain a minimum capital of 8%. Minimum capital adequacy ratio at that point of time was 8%, but that was quite inefficient accord. That is the reason the deficiencies in Basel I has given rise to the Basel II accord. And thus, after a consultative feedback from different banks, from different financial institutions, BCBS has issued the revised framework on June 26, 2004. Now, what is the difference between Basel I and Basel II? Basel I has given importance to the credit risk only. But for the Basel II part, there were three pillars. So let us discuss the three pillars of Basel II. Here, the three pillars of Basel II was Pillar 1, Pillar 2, and Pillar 3. There, the Pillar 1 was against the minimum capital requirement, which I have already stated in the last slide, that is 8% of the total capital. Here, they have given importance to the credit part only. But for the Basel II, there are three pillars, and this pillar two stands for the supervisory review process. It means that here they will be going to take into consideration the internal assessment of the banks, internal processes of the banks as well. And pillar three stands for the disclosure requirements, which means what are the different pieces of information that should be disclosed to the market participants so that they will be able to know about the current situation of the banking system. Finally, the deficiencies of Basel II give rise to the implementation or the evolvement of the Basel III part. The Reserve Bank of India has given guidelines on capital reform for absorbing capital default risk on May 2, 2012, and it was supposed to be implemented by April 1, 2013. But for developing countries like India, the phase-wise implementation was suggested and the time framework was March 31, 2019. But till now, the time of 2021 is going on and still the banks are facing challenges in the implementation as well as execution of Basel III norms. Now coming forward to the objective parts. What are the objectives behind this review paper? Firstly, to gain knowledge about the studies that have been conducted on Basel norms, means different studies that have been conducted for Basel I norm, Basel II and Basel III. Next is to find out the research gaps in studies conducted on Basel norms as well as capital adequacy. Next is to study the impact critical assessment of Basel III norms on management of non-performing assets. And finally, to study the effectiveness of Basel III norms in mitigating the risk of banking industry. Next is the review of literature part. Though I have studied around 30 to 35 papers for this this review paper, but because we are having less time, so I have only given the 5 reviews in this presentation, starting with the first one. The paper which is being given by the Nawaz Jalaluddin, the title of the paper was How the Banks Have Adjusted Their Capital Ratios to Meet the Regulatory Requirements. That is also an empirical analysis part, where the author have taken the sample of 47 banks, which includes 23 private and 24 public sector banks. Basically, the author just want to see that are the different banks able to adjust their capital ratios according to the minimum capital requirements. And apart from this, there is one more author, that is Bura and Zangra. They have already studied the preparedness level of Indian public sector banks for the implementation of Basel III norm. So there are different authors who have already studied about the Basel I norms, Basel II norms, and so on. So moving to the research gaps, after an extensive review of various studies on Basel norms and its implementation towards capital adequacy in commercial banking sector, what we have found that most of the studies are being conducted at international scenarios only. And most of the studies which are conducted in Indian context, they have their focus on how part. Meanwhile, they just aim to find how the banks are adjusting their capital requirements. There are enough literature present about the implementation and preparedness, but what about the execution challenges? Means, what is the future scope to deal with these challenges? Are these capital norms will be effective enough in mitigating bank risk? What will be the impact on future profitability of banks? So with this, what I have concluded, that there is enough part for future research on the topic, that is the impact of critical assessment of Basel III norms on management of banks' failure risk and even on the challenges which are being faced by banking entities for execution of capital norms. And this is this can be the topic for future research of mine. Means in future, I will be conducting my research on the topic that how are Indian sector banks will be going to follow the Basel III norms, how they will be going to execute these norms, what are the different challenges they will be following physically as well as in the banking scenario, how they will be mitigating everything in Basel III. So these are the references. And thank you for listening.
Okay, madam. Okay. So my question.
Yes, sir.
What are the special features of Basel III norms?
So basically, Basel III norms are also implement are taken place after Basel II norms only, and Basel II norms falls on three pillars in which they have been taken into consideration the credit risk. Apart from this, there are different supervisory measures they have been taken, and finally the market disciplinary part. But in the Basel, but there are deficiencies in Basel II norms, and thus there is a part that has given the path to the Basel III part. Means basically after Basel II, Basel III arises, and this also take into consideration all the three same pillars only.
Okay, Kinnari madam.
Yes.
Okay. So, madam, how many of them are following these? How many banks are following this? It is compulsory, but how many of them are following all the rules and provisions very strictly and stringently?
Not exactly. I don't know about how many banks. Basically, this is made compulsory by the every country who is the part of who is a member of Basel Committee. So this is made compulsory to be followed by every.
Yeah, there are so many things which are mandatory. There are so many things which are compulsory. But you know, there are always loopholes which are found in implementation or in following the rules. So any idea about in your you have just studied about the norms. Have you checked whether the banks are actually following those, adhering to those norms?
Ma'am, that is a part of my future research. I have just studied about different norms in Basel I, Basel II, and Basel III part. Now this is my this will be my future research, that how many of the banks are actually following them, and what are the challenges they will be following in the they will be getting in this implementation part.
Okay, what is the main difference between Basel II, difference between Basel II and Basel III norms?
Ma'am, under starting with the Basel I, they are focusing upon the credit risk on failure only. When coming to the Basel II, they have taken into consideration credit risk, market risk, operational risk as well. And when coming to the Basel III part, they are taking into consideration the supervisory processes and the market discipline as well.
Okay, that's it from my side.
Okay, thank you, madam. Thank you. So the fourth presentation, the title of the paper, Role of Faith-Based Organization as Facilitators of Credit in Society. Akhil Menon, Institute of Management in Government, University of Kerala, and Dr. Sulina Via, St. Joseph College for Women, Alappuzha. So Akhil Menon, you start your presentation.
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Okay, very good afternoon to everyone. I am Akhil Menon, currently pursuing research in commerce in IMG, Trivandrum, under the guidance of Dr. Sulina V.S. I am here to present our work on a research article titled The Role of Faith-Based Organizations as Facilitators of Credit in the Society. Sir, are you able to see the slide also?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Introduction. See, faith-based organizations are connected with religious communities and operate in varying size and context. They work for the welfare of the community members as well as the poor among them. They are basically influenced by the religious values. For example, in the case of Kerala, the Nair Service Society, the SNDP, or the Catholic churches, etc., are an example of these faith-based organizations. In our study, there is a formal definition for faith-based organizations, which has been set by Bhanu and Padmaja Nair. They define faith-based organizations as religiously inspired service organizations. The idea of religion or faith in development policies of the state is not a new one. And basically, it has been argued by scholars such as Tomlin, Clerk, that religion in the form of these faith-based organizations had a very vast impact on the lives of many through various interventions by way of religious services and also non-religious services, especially in the field of health, education, and related sectors. but actually the role that they can play in facilitation of credit has not been much inquired about, especially the case of Kerala, how it has not been inquired. The next is about the statement of the problem. Why the study was being done actually was the literature on faith and development initially advocated for integrating the concept of faith-based organizations into various government welfare programs. But later they considered them as only agents of development which are motivated by faith traditions. Nonetheless, the development potential of these was not explored by the literature. Especially, these can be very useful to achieve financial inclusions of people who are excluded due to many factors, which we would say. Why the objectives of this study is basically to examine the role of faith-based organizations as facilitators of credit in the society. And the study talks about the context in which such a mechanism has been warranted, the issues that arise in accessing of credit by the households or individuals, especially among the backward sections in the society. And the study further states the theoretical underpinning for initiating such organizations into the existing credit delivery mechanisms. The paper is basically a descriptive one, a conceptual one, and it is exploratory in the sense that the potential of the faith-based organization in credit delivery mechanism has been studied in the study. The analysis, when we come to the findings of the study, the context in which we have studied the role of faith-based organization is the fact that the influence of religious beliefs on economic outcomes have also provided a negative outlook. The case of especially a religiosity, where we are giving importance to religion, especially Shariat law among the Muslim society, is against taking credit, taking interest for credit. So basically these things can have a negative influence on accessing credit, especially among those religious. And also the case of India, there is a lot of perceived caste discrimination, especially among the backward societies. And in such light, customers show variation in their views of culturally distinct service personnel. And in the study by Kulik and Holbrook, he states that if the service is delivered by workers with the same community, clients view the service performance more favorable. And coming to this was about the demand dimension, how this the context of the demand dimension. Financial access has both a demand dimension and a supply dimension. When you talk on to the supply dimension, the supply of credit by the financial providers are basically affected by transaction costs and information cost. Transaction cost basically involve the processing and other related cost, which is associated with small amount of loan, which basically has been taken by those poor people or backward sections. In case of the information asymmetry, basically in India and all over the world, the poor actually has incomplete records or imperfect information, are not able to give actual records regarding their income and other sources. So in this case, financial access to credit has been empirically proved in other studies also very restrained. So we are giving an idea of how we are exploring the idea of how faith-based organizations can facilitate credit delivery, especially in rural areas. And I would say they can do it both directly and indirectly. This research, actually I did undertake a ground level happening of what is been happening regarding this. And in certain cases, direct services are being provided. The organizations themselves pool resources, money from their community members, and offer small loans, redistribute these to the community members who are financially excluded among them. And indirectly, how these faith-based organizations can play a big role is they accelerate the credit delivery mechanism by providing lenders with monitoring advantages. And also, they are able to mitigate the risk of moral hazard by exerting a social cost in case of default. So these, theoretically speaking, faith-based organization can facilitate rural credit delivery in a better way. In the ground level, in a small sense, I have seen such type of interventions by certain churches, etc., where they are able to, they coordinate with the formal financial institutions such as banks, and are distributing a small amount of loan among those members with small amount. And in most of these cases, it is beneficial for bank also, because they are able to reduce their paperwork, especially for small loans to be given, and the monitoring cost is also low, as most of these would be checked by the specific organizations which is undertaking these coordinating activities. So in certain rural areas, we have seen that these are indeed happening, but the implications of this is actually not been studied, or you don't find such financial arrangements, how these are happening in the ground level in most of the studies. If we incorporate these things, actually the theoretical framework, it is having a lot of theoretical undertaking or underpinning also, because the community echelon theory suggested by Osley in 2020 even suggested that communal representatives, through these people, financial or inclusion should be offered to these people, because it suggests that most of these community leaders are active in their communities, and we can use these influence to motivate or convince members to engage with the formal financial sector or the banks. Why is this being studied? Because even in certain cases, especially in rural area, even though there is presence of banks, the uptake of credit, etc., is very low, even among the backward communities, and they are basically intaking informal finance. So in such cases, these leaders can play a big role. And in case of participation, why these people participate in credit services, maybe the social identity theory, which states that the self-conception as a group member among these group can help to say why these people actually participated. Because in India, individuals are often identified on the basis of religion and caste. And these religion distinguishes an individual from others, and thus, when this identity actually is high, the greater is the potential to affect a participant or into participate in the programs or collaborate with the respective financial or the
Please conclude.
So the conclusion of the study is basically, the study examined the role of faith-based organization in credit delivery, and in areas where it is very low, population which is financially excluded due to socio-cultural factors, we may be able to attract them to the formal setup. However, in-depth evaluation is needed. Its practical implication is to be evaluated. Only then can a viable idea be formulated. So thank you, sir, for patiently listening to my presentation. And any more questions, sir?
So Akhil Menon, do you believe that this type of organizations render excellent financial service to the people staying in the rural area?
Sir, I have seen that in Kottapuram, in one of the rural areas in Thrissur, where there are churches in turn collaborate with the banks. In case I went to one of the public sector, I talked to one of the manager there, and they are able to give loans in collaboration with this institution informally. These churches in turn will act as intermediary, collect these people, and a whole amount is disbursed to them, which is in turn distributed to others. So within a single paperwork, this is being done in some of the rural areas. I have talked with one person, so that is why that motivated me to just study.
Okay, Nikhil. Kinnari madam?
Yes, sir.
Start.
So have you actually interviewed or found out from these such kind of organizations that you know, which kind of credit mechanism they follow? You have direct contact with any such kind of organizations?
I basically talked with the banks, especially a zonal manager was there. I met him when I was asking about the access to credit.
Do they belong to these faith-based organizations? Banks, are they a part of faith-based organizations?
No, banks were not part. No, but
my direct straight question is, have you interacted with them before any kind of study or conclusion which you have derived from this?
Yes, madam. I among one or two people who have taken loan also suggested that how they got their loan. Actually, they got it from the bank. But even then, what is happening there is they have not provided any secured debt or any collateral there. Then I told how did they get the bank. Then I approached one of the manager there, and he said this is an info. Hello.
Yeah, continue.
And he said that this is an informal arrangement where we talked especially with these people where loan is being provided in the guarantee by the churches that it would be got. And he gave an overview that most of these loan are actually, they are paying the best. There is very less non-performing asset in this case of loan unless there is any debt, etc. And they are saying that it is indeed very helpful. For example, people who are taking loan in case of certain emergencies, for example, maybe 20,000 rupees or 30,000 rupees. In these cases, those who are not able to get a loan, they might be going through this procedure. So the banks are, what I heard from them is they are able to also make a good profit, even though it might be low. They are able to have this operationalized in the ground.
Okay, Nikhil. That's enough. So, move on to the next presentation. Title, an overview of Islamic banking in Hyderabad, Karnataka region, the least hit chicked channel by Muhammad Farsana Begum, Devika Rani P, Dr. Muhammad Javed Kulbadi. Please start. Muhammad Farnasa Begum.
Yes, sir. Hello.
You start your presentation.
Sir, screen is audible?
No. We can't see your PPT.
Slide is not visible. Can you share it?
Yeah. Just I'm sharing the screen, sir.
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt. Your screen is not visible.
Yes, ma'am. I'm sharing the screen.
Do you have any problem to share the screen?
I'm trying, sir. I'm trying to share it on the screen. Sir, is it visible right now?
No.
No, it's not visible, ma'am. Ma'am, you can share the PPT from the icon below. Share icon.
Yeah, that is what, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Click the share option.
Actually, there is some problem, sir.
Okay. Ma'am, you can wait and the next presenter will do right now.
Sir, 1 second, sir. It got open.
Yeah.
Sir.
Participants, a gentle reminder, before you start your presentation, please try to keep it short, including the major findings. Thank you.
Sir, is it possible, like you can share it on the screen, sir, my PPT? If you don't mind.
Can you send your PPT? Yeah, now it's sharing. It's working. Yeah, now it is visible. Please.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So respected chair members, Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, dignitaries and my dear colleagues, a very warm good afternoon to one and all. Now I would like to present on the topic an overview of Islamic banking in Hyderabad, Karnataka region, the least hitchhike channel.
Please make it shorter because we are running short of time.
Yeah.
We have another
session.
Yes,
sir. Looking at the introduction, the global procession of beginning of the 15th Hijra century, that is as per the Islamic calendar, in mid of the 1970s, this concept of Islamic banking has begun. So the Islamic Development Bank, the first Sharia compliant development bank in the world, it was founded in the year 1974. So this Islamic banking, it can be considered as a banking system which is based on Sharia principles and ideologies. Looking at the statement of the problem, here the major problem, like the statement of the problem, what we have considered, that is to examine the impact of demographic and socio-economic variables on understanding of Islamic banking in Hyderabad, Karnataka region. Why we have opted this particular region is that this region, it comprises of six districts, that is Bellary, Bidar, Gulbarga, Raichur, Vijayanagara and Koppal. This region, it comes under the purview of Article 371J, where this article of the Constitution of India, it provides a special status for this region. This Article 371J, it grants special status to six backward districts, the districts which I have kept in front of you people right now. Like we have the three major considerations, like why it comes under the special status. So the first point here, it establishes a separate development board. The board ensures sufficient funds are allocated for the development of the region and the local reservation in education and to provide the n number of government jobs. Looking at the objectives of the study, to acquire a basic understanding of Islamic banking, to outline the basic principles in Islamic banking, to identify the financing modes and objectives of Islamic banking, and to examine the impact of demographic and socio-economic variables on understanding of Islamic banking. Looking at the research methodology, data was collected both from primary and secondary sources. Primary sources were we have used a structured standardized questionnaire which was administered to 250 respondents of HK region. Coming to the secondary data, it has been collected from websites, newspapers, blogs, research articles. Okay, then sampling size, as I said, it is 250 respondents. We used a convenient sampling technique, and the assessment tool was a standardized questionnaire where we have taken the help of this Likert scale to analyze the responses from the survey. And the statistical tool which was used, that is, we use simple percentage method, mean, and Karl Pearson's chi-square test. Coming to the analysis and discussion part, directly I'm moving to the hypothesis test result, where we have found out that there is a direct connection between respondents' age, educational background, and Islamic banking understanding. Looking at the second hypothesis outcome, like what we have found out is that there is no link, there is no interrelationship between respondents' occupation and the understanding of Islamic banking. Looking at the awareness of Islamic banking in HK region, we have considered 10 factors where these 10 factors with different mean projections. And the percentages, like the first factor, it projected a mean of 1.69, which shows majority of them, they have agreed that this Islamic banking, it is a new banking system. where second factor recorded the mean score of 1.12, which shows 92% of the respondents agreed that Islamic banking is purely based on Sharia laws and principles. Looking at the third factor, which recorded a mean of 1.22, which shows 87% of them opined that this banking is completely different from conventional and commercial banking, where the fourth factor projected a mean of 1.16 and shows 91% of them believed that this banking is invested in ethical ventures. So it is also called as ethical banking. Fifth factor, which projected a mean of 1.13, shows that 93% of them accepted that Islamic banking, it involves the principle of profit and loss sharing principle. The sixth factor, which projected a mean of 1.12, which shows 91% of the respondents agree that it prohibits investing in illegal businesses. Seventh factor, which recorded a mean of 1.09, showed that 94% of them considered this banking as an interest-free banking, which is based on RIBA principle, where 8th and 9th factors, they had a mean score of 1.17, which shows 88% of them think that this banking's goal is not only to maximize the wealth, but also to enhance the welfare of the society. Societal welfare principle here is a major consideration. And 87% of them were aware of financing methods, which comes under Islamic banking, whereas the last factor, which recorded a mean of 1.12, which shows that 93% of them agreed that Islamic banking, it contributes more to societal balance, human prosperity and welfare. Coming to the conclusion and suggestions, what we can say is that Islamic banking is still in its infancy around the world, taking global scenario into consideration. And what we felt is that this Islamic banking, it has a potential to increase the financial inclusion, which is very crucial and significant parameter for our country. And the second point is that it would be acting as another alternative mode of banking that would strengthen market efficiencies with different innovations and competition. This is in general conclusion. Particularly, it was found that taking the HK region into consideration from the 250 respondents' outcome, what we have found out is that there is a very strong connection, there is a very strong relationship between respondents' age, qualification, and understanding of Islamic banking. This is what we have found out in our study. So these are the references. We have referred 20 to 25.
Okay, madam. Okay, madam. Okay, madam.
Yes, okay. Yes.
So in Hyderabad and Karnataka, in which state Islamic banking has more scope and importance, whether it is in Hyderabad or in Karnataka?
Sir, actually, Hyderabad and Karnataka, it is a combination of the districts which fall under the borders of both Andhra as well as Karnataka, sir. Looking at the population of our state, that is the Karnataka, right now we are standing with a population of 7.05 crores, where HK region is comprising of 18% of the total population. That is somewhere it comes
around 1.3 crores. Okay, madam, I know. So after comparison of the Islamic banking practices, yes, in these two states,
yes,
which is your, what is your conclusion?
Yes,
and whether,
yes,
the,
sir,
Islamic banking has more importance or scope in Hyderabad or in Karnataka? That's my question.
Yes, sir. Why? Because HK region is a region which comes under the purview of Article 371J, like I have already explained. This Article 371J, it is granting a special status to these six backward districts. Like coming to the this one, sir, like literacy rates also, the literacy rates of this region is 64%, where the entire state literacy rate is standing at 75%.
Okay, madam. Kinderi, madam.
So that is the reason we have considered this particular region for our studies.
Kinderi, madam.
Yes, sir. I was waiting for madam to complete.
Yeah, please, ma'am.
Okay, I have, you know, in the conclusion, you have mentioned that there is a strong linkage between respondents' age, qualification, and understanding. So, what yes, can you explain this in yes, more ma'am. Detail?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I'll explain. Like, ma'am, looking at the respondent stage, we have categorized into five categories, like respondents who fall below 20 years. Second category, which includes the respondents who are coming in between 21 to 30, then 31 to 40, then 41 to 50, then last category, which is above 50 years.
Okay.
So, like what we have found out in our study is that the people who are falling in between 41 to 50,
okay,
they have a more awareness on this awareness and understanding on the concept of Islamic banking. And okay, looking at the qualification, madam, qualification we have taken, we have classified into like people who are qualified up to higher secondary education, people who are diplomats, people who are undergraduates, postgraduates, and PhD or doctorates. So out of from our study, what we have found out is that people who are undergraduates, they have more understanding of the concept of Islamic banking in this particular region.
Okay, so what kind of population, what kind of sample size you had collected, and the sample size, did they belong to any kind of religion, which if you have, in case if you have taken the responses?
No, like questionnaire itself, we have not mentioned anywhere like whether the respondent is Muslim or a non-Muslim in general. We have targeted only 250 respondents, madam.
Okay. So other than the religion also, were aware of the details, the intricacies of the Islamic banking, or they were just aware? See, awareness can be just knowing it, but detailed awareness.
Yeah, yes,
so do you find that others who were aware of the intricacies and the entire system of Islamic banking?
Ma'am, it's just an awareness. So people who have, like we have mentioned in the factors, like last part of the interpretation part, if you look at agreement levels, taking 10 factors into consideration, where like 2 to 3 factors where they are speaking on the Islamic banking principles as well as the financing modes and methods of Islamic banking. So those people whom we have responded and what we have received the outcomes, they were having sufficient knowledge on these parameters.
Okay, no problem. Yeah. That's it from us.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Thank you for giving me this wonderful opportunity.
Thank you, ma'am. So, next we invite Shifana Shireen KT, Naja Hussein Adal, and Shreya Suresh, PG students, Department of Commerce, Safi Institute of Advanced Studies, to present their topic, A Comparative Study on Non-Performing Assets of Indian Banks.
We have some technical issues. 1 minute.
Yes, you can share your screen.
Sir, please give us a few time.
Karen?
Shifana, can you hear me? Is there any problem, Shifana?
Shifana, do you are facing any problem?
Yeah, we have some technical issues.
Okay, fine. You wait, and the other presenter will host. You can call the other presenter by the time Shifana will be ready. So Shifana, okay, the host. Right.
So next, I invite Aisha Fida SP, PG student, in Safi Institute of Advanced Study, and Rinshia M and Shahana Fida, Department of Commerce, Safi Institute of Advanced Study, to present their topic, A Comparative Study of E-Banking Services in Public and Private Sector Banks.
Yes, your screen is visible. You can continue with your presentation.
So the screen is visible. You can continue with your presentation. Hello.
Hello, Aisha, is it? Can you hear us? So shall we continue with the next participant?
Yeah, please stop sharing. The next participant will start presentation.
Hello, okay. Sir, audible?
Yeah, now it's audible.
Respected Professor P.A. Harikumar, sir, University of Kerala, and Dr. Inneri V. Thekkar, University of Mumbai, and other dignitaries. A warm good afternoon to one and all. Here I am to present a seminar on the topic, a comparative study of e-bank services in private bank and private sector bank. The authors are Rinshia and Fida, myself Aisha from Safi Advanced Study under University of Calicut. Banking is the activity of accepting for the purpose of lending money. But nowadays, the banking industry is being reached by globalization, competition, and innovation and customer needs due to emergency-based economy and society as information and communication technology advances. The most important factor in the development of banking enables bank to create sophisticated products, to have better market infrastructure, and to reach geographically distant and diversified markets. Furthermore, consumers' banking needs and demands have changed significantly over the past few decades. They face today more personalized banking products and services,
Aisha,
and they expect
Aisha, to Aisha, madam, please do not read the full slide.
Time and any place.
Aisha, are you hearing? So it is not like reading the slide, you just present it. You present your findings, conclusion, objectives, methodology, etc.
Please only mention your objectives, findings, conclusion. Do not read your slide full. We have already read that. Mention your objectives and do not...
Sir.
It's visible. You take your methodology part.
Can you visible, sir? Hello, sir.
Yes, you are audible.
Can you visible?
Visible.
It's visible. It is audible.
Madam, one thing you should remember: you come to the methodology, then discussion, and findings and conclusion. Okay.
Okay, sir. The study includes private sector banks and public sector banks like Canara Bank and Yes Bank, as well as IDBI and Axis Bank. The banking service provided by the banks were collected from respective websites in order to make the analysis of its effectiveness. The present study is descriptive in nature, conducted by using secondary data. types of e-bank services.
Please skip this slide because it's already, we have theories. Next slide.
Okay. Analysis on results of e-bank services of Canara Bank. The services provided by Canara Bank are PFMS through net banking, Canara Bank, Suganya Samriddhi scheme, and online tax payments are the e-bank services provided by Canara Bank. PFMS is financial management system on software application developed by the Control General of Accounts. Their objective of tracking funds is the government of India and real-time of expenditure at all implicated. Can Money is stockbroking and trading service providing group.
Your voice is breaking.
So there is issue of Wi-Fi.
Okay, you conclude. Please conclude.
The conclusion of this study is in extensive analysis of difference between public sector banks and private sector banks in India in terms of e-bank services. E-bank of banking, going online or buying has become a trend among the customers, and also it helps improve the relationship between bankers and consumers. Dixit and MSK Data, Satya Swaroop, www.esbank.in, www.idbbank.com, www.xbank.com, www.canarabank.com. Thank you for listening to the topic. Thank you, sir. Sorry for the inconvenience.
Can I ask a question, madam, sir?
Yes, yes, madam. You can ask.
Madam, why did you include Yes Bank?
So, because, ma'am, it's a private sector bank, but the control and rights are.
No, but what is the performance of Yes Bank since last year? Have you checked the performance of Yes Bank since last year?
No, ma'am.
Okay, just that was my question. Sir, you can continue.
The bank
you can
was
check in trouble. Later on.
The bank was in trouble, right? So the man asking, why did you include Yes Bank as your
No problem, sir. You can continue.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Hari Kumar, sir.
Please ask the next participant to proceed.
Okay, thanks. So thank you, Aisha.
Sorry, sir, for the inconvenience.
Okay. Next participant.
Now we invite Meera N., research scholar, Department of Economics, University of Kerala, to present her paper on making finance work for the planet, role of sustainable finance.
Madam, how many participants? We are already at 3 o'clock now.
Ma'am, there are two more participants now.
Only two more? More?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes. Ma'am. Yes.
Yes, Meera, please start your presentation.
Meera, your slide is visible. You can start your presentation.
Meera? Mirak, you can start your presentation.
Sir, it seems there is a technical glitch. Shall we continue with our next participant? Because there is a time constraint.
That's better.
Yes, sir. I invite Ms. Sameena Ghassal, Aligarh Muslim University, to present on the topic, an empirical investigation of research and development expenditure and firm performance, evidence from Indian companies.
Good evening to everyone. Am I visible?
Meera?
Sir, can I continue, sir?
Because we haven't heard your voice. Can you share it again if possible?
Yes, sir. Respected chairperson.
Yeah, continue.
Respected chairpersons, the topic of my presentation today is making finance work for the planet, role of sustainable finance. So finance, as we all know, have long been criticized as only profit seeking and ignoring other aspects of ecology, society, and so on. But it has also been told as one of the hindrances to a better and sustainable planet. So the paper aims to develop a perspective through which governments and corporates can use finance as a tool to promote sustainability and prevent social and environmental imbalances from being exacerbated. So climate-related risks have become very much a reality, and it is gripping human interactions at an unprecedented scale. This is evidenced by the fact that the World Economic Forum's Risk Report 2020 has ranked climate related as number one risk by its impact, and number two by its likelihood to materialize over the next years, and also our vulnerability in terms of climate risk has risen, and now India is fifth most vulnerable. Also, India has recorded the second highest monetary loss from climate change in 2018. So, and a US-based National Bureau of Economic Research study says that India's GDP may well shrink by 10% by the end of the century. And we also have our commitments and our action plans cut out for the Paris Agreement. So in such a context where multilateral institutions are all calling for serious action to limit the extent of the climate crisis, finance can play a pivotal role in aiding a smooth transition to a low carbon economy. So it is in recognition of this fact that a relatively new offshoot of finance, sustainable finance, has come to take center stage. So it involves factoring in the various environmental, social, and corporate governance related parameters, that is ESG parameters, into analyzing the viability and also analyzing the future prospects of a project. ESG factors are often given an upper hand in investment decisions these days, though it has not gained traction all over the world. It is being taken care of. Sustainable finance has a key role to play in mobilizing the capital that's necessary in order to facilitate a smooth transition. The concept is also very much in line with the UN Sustainable Development Goals, and especially when we view through the prism of the current ongoing pandemic and its impact on the global economy. It shows that sustainable finance can surely help us build a resilient economy and also ensure that the recovery that we have is sustainable. Now, coming to the before the objectives, I would also like to say that the externalities of the current carbon intensive growth path that we are following is becoming increasingly clear. It is becoming increasingly clear to the public that a transition to a carbon neutral or low carbon economy is imperative. And it is evident, like, for example, in the 1990s, we had the Californian air pollution crisis. And also these days, we have rising instances of extreme weather events, which has made countries close to the equatorial region more prone to such climate-related catastrophes. So all these have prompted a transition to electric cars, such as those pioneered by Tesla and so on. So finance is by accelerating the migration to sustainable finance, we can contribute to a swift transition to a low carbon economy. The main objectives of this paper is to explore the different international and national finance initiatives that aim at a low carbon transition, and also to explore the recent developments in India's green bond market. The approach of the paper is predominantly exploratory, and it uses secondary data sources for studying the impact of sustainable finance. Main recourse of the study is the progress made by multilateral bodies in this front, including working papers and other reports. The global best practices and experiences, as well as Indian attempts at bringing sustainability to the finance front, even though it's a relatively new idea, it is summarized and compiled so that we can fashion a possible future course of action and also enlist the caveats that we need to take care of. Now coming to the discussion part, climate change and the associated problems suffer from the tragedy of the horizon. Tragedy of the horizon being the term coined by Mark Carney, former governor of Bank of England. He mentioned that tragedy of the horizon is the main problem with respect to climate change, since most regulators, policymakers, and politicians, they all have a time span of 4 to 5 years. And most technocrats also are in office only for a period of 4 to 5 years. So there is a lack of incentive on their part to take decisive action to curb climate change. So that is why we need to take care of the E in ESG. And also when it comes to the social vulnerabilities that have already been there and which have been exacerbated by the pandemic and the resultant impact on the economy, the inequality and all, we also have this prospect of facing a K-shaped recovery in the future. So given all this, the case for sustainable finance is very strong. And with rising awareness of the impact of climate change on human well-being, as well as its impact on the financial system, its potential impact, there have been attempts to create an investment decision metrics that would help reveal the environmental and social impacts of investment. This is already visible in the global lending and investing practices, and it's due to the possibility, due to this possibility, that despite generating high profits, companies could lose prominence in the investment horizon if they have low ESG scores and thereby risk losing capital flows. So this approach has become popular in many parts of the world, such as Europe, while the idea is only gaining traction in the rest of the world. The ESG factors have gained global relevance and are increasingly being recognized as indicators of long-term value creation. Also, along with that, they serve as a key metric by which we can gauge the future resilience and potential of the company, thus providing important material information to investors and stakeholders in decision-making. We also have several initiatives that incentivize the adoption of sustainable and green finance, such as the S&P Dow Jones Sustainability Index, which also tracks the ESG criteria followed by companies. India, for one, has been at the forefront of adopting green finance through rapid mobilization and use of green bonds as key vehicles. We are, in fact, the second largest green bond market in emerging market economies, second only to China. So green bonds are actually a subset of corporate bonds, and the only difference lies in the fact that they are used for financing green projects. For example, as spelled out by SEBI, some of the projects include renewable and sustainable energy projects, clean transportation, energy efficiency, climate change adaptation, sustainable land and water management, waste management, and biodiversity conservation. So some of the initiatives taken globally include the Climate Bonds Initiative, which aims to mobilize a 100 trillion bond market for climate change solutions by providing a market for a rapid transition. And they also provide market intelligence, and they tie up with governments and the industry. Next, another key initiative is the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosures. It is an initiative of the European Commission's Financial Stability Board. It has developed voluntary, consistent climate-related financial risk disclosures. by which companies can provide information to investors, lenders, insurers, and other stakeholders. So another important initiative is the NGFS, or the Network of Central Bankers and Supervisors for Greening the Financial System. It shares best practices and aims to enhance the role of the financial system to manage risks and to mobilize capital for green and low carbon economy. So many emerging market central banks and financial authorities are also seen to be aboard this initiative, while India is not yet in it. Another important initiative is that of the European Union's green taxonomy and green bond standards. So they have developed again a voluntary standard which would facilitate alignment of different disclosures in line with the EU green taxonomy. Also, the UN Principles for Responsible Investing, it is also an initiative which gives which supports an international network of investors working together to implement the aspirational principles related to the ESG framework. But it also, here again, it depends on the voluntary disclosure of signatories. Next is the Sustainable Banking Network. I'll move to the next. I'm just moving to the Indian context.
Conclusion.
In India's green bond market, we have this. In India, we have green bond markets, which form a meager 0.35% of our total debt, but it ranks fifth among the G20 economies. Another peculiarity is that our issues, especially the IREDA, the Indian Renewable Energy Development Authority's issue, was oversubscribed to the extent of 5.1 times in 2016. So that shows an illustrious beginning. But one of the major findings is that this half of the size of the issue ranges between 100 to 500 million. So it is of a relatively smaller size. And I've already mentioned the different categories. Now, SEBI has also taken upon itself the responsibility to evaluate green bond issuances on what constitutes green. It is taking it on a case-by-case basis. So this obviates the need for the market participants to go into the nuances of each issue and to gather information. So even though green bonds are a relatively new type of financial instrument, maybe because of that per se, it is considered as higher risk instruments and are yet to establish a financial and credit profile that matches the, the actual risk return characteristics of conventional bonds. So another thing is, as I mentioned, the smaller size of it itself makes it a bit difficult to gain. Sorry, ma'am, could you please repeat?
You have exceeded your time.
Yes, ma'am. Conclude.
Yes, ma'am.
Challenges that faces in India is that lack of measures to support this high potential but nascent sector. Another is lack of a sound methodology for evaluating the diverse issuances, and also on having a proper standardized taxonomy which prevents greenwashing, and also we need a sector-wise diversification. So to conclude, I would say the need to incorporate sustainability in financing decisions is very important, and it is considered as more of a reputational risk if it is not factored in. Sustainable finance has become a key to sustainable business models, and it is especially important in the case of a transition. So however, greenwashing and other such challenges brings significant reputational risk to socially oriented investors seeking to diversify their portfolios. Therefore, the need of the hour is to have more research in the field of finance to make green investments more attractive in terms of their risk return framework. So some of the suggestions that I would like to say is development banks in the Indian context, such as SIDBI and NABARD, could be asked to tap these opportunities. Also, corporate bond market, which is relatively nascent. Even it is not much developed in India, the green bond market in particular. So all these need to be taken into account. Fiscal incentives and monetary policy incentives need to be in place. Also, we need to expand the ambit of priority sector lending to include different sectors. And the investor awareness and risk appetite for the segment also needs to be augmented. Therefore, a regulatory intervention to enhance and strengthen the standards also is the need of the hour. Thank you.
Okay, madam, which is your major finding? Major finding.
Sir, one of the major finding is that there is still untapped potential in the Indian green bond market, which needs to be augmented. So there is a lot of room for government intervention in terms of fiscal incentives, and also the role of central banks has been overlooked. It needs to be.
Okay. So what is your practical suggestion for this particular negative findings?
Yes, sir. I would say that especially in companies going for issuances needs to be incentivized so that they make more room for green investments also.
Okay, madam. Thank you.
Question is, how do you integrate this topic of yours with the sustainable development goals, which is just the recent policies of sustainable development goals, which has been implemented, which has been the policy document which has been released?
Yes, ma'am. Sustainable development goals within that framework, sustainable development goal number 13, it enumerates climate action. So it is one of the key areas where we can integrate sustainable finance into the SDG framework, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, madam, we can proceed with the next.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay, ma'am. We have the last participant of this session, Samina Ghassal, Ms. Samina Ghassal and Dr. Tariq Aziz of Aligarh Muslim University, to present on the title, An Empirical Investigation of Research and Development Expenditure and Firm Performance, Evidence from Indian Companies. Ma'am, you can present your slides.
Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Slide is visible.
Yes, your slides also are visible.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Samina from Aligarh Muslim University, and the topic of my presentation is an empirical investigation of R&D expenditure and firm performance, evidence from Indian companies. The reason why I have taken this topic is, over the last few decades, a significant change has been noticed, that is a shift from tangible based economy to intangible economy. That is, intangible is basically investment in ideas and knowledge in aesthetics, software, and etc. In the present scenario, modern economics undertakes both physical as well as intangible assets, that is brand value, patent, business R&D, advertising expenditure, and many more. The large part of a firm's value carries intangible assets, and the reason for the shift from the tangible to intangible capital is basically the technological growth, increased competition as a result of deregulation, privatization, and globalization. Problem basically, in short, we will say that accounting regulators, although this is a very important aspect, the relationship between one of the major type of intangible asset, that is R&D, and firm performance have been a matter of interest for the last few decades. However, accounting regulators still treat these value creating intangible investments as regular expenses like salaries, rent, interest, etc. The major objective of my study is to investigate the role of R&D expenditure in a stock return prediction, to investigate the role of R&D expenditure industry-wise stock return prediction. Moving towards methodology, the time frame of my studies of 20 years, that is 2000 to 2019, the data collection is from ProVest IQ database.
analysis we have done using Excel and eViews. The sampling frame is all listed manufacturing companies, and after that I have applied few truncation rules. So, and the final sample of my study was 1097 companies, which was segregated in 6 major industries as given in the slide. And the model of regression analysis I have used is Fama, French and Cahart regression analysis, which carries these 4 factors, that is excess return, SMB, that is small minus big sample, that is the size effect, refers to the fact that stocks with small market capitalization have on average and in long run outperform stocks with large market cap, and value effect, that is HML, refers to the fact that a stock with high book to market ratio historically outperform the stocks with low book to market, and the momentum factor. And the technique of estimation I have used is portfolio analysis methodology. In that methodology, I have overall sample is overall 1097 companies. I have made quintile portfolios, that is 5 portfolios starting from lowest portfolio based on R&D intensity. That is R&D expenditure relative to market value, book value, sales and profit. But due to brevity of space, I have shown here only the market, R&D related to market value. And here the excess return 4 factor alphas have been shown. And EW portfolios basically are equal weighted portfolio. They are basically the average of portfolio, that is average of the market return. And VW, that is value weighted, are the market cap weighted returns. And here, this is the overall sample, and which shows that a pattern is being formed, that is lower the R&D expenditure, lower the return in subsequent year, that is next year. And for as we can say, that as the portfolio is increasing, as we are going moving towards the higher R&D relative intensive companies, the return we are getting more. And the hedge portfolio, that is basically the highest minus lowest portfolio, is showing the significant result. That means the impact or the effect of R&D is present in the whole sample. And if we talk about the industry segregation, here the result are of a kind of heterogeneous result. Like we can see the transportation industry is showing the best result, after that following by textile, and there is no impact or no effect of R&D on computer programming and software services. Moving towards discussion, first examine the relationship by constructing the portfolio, as I have already explained. The study shows that there is a presence of R&D impact in the whole sample, but the result of industry-wise analysis shows that there is no effect, or we can say a heterogeneous effect has been shown in industry-wise analysis. Score, this paper establishes whether there is a positive relationship between R&D expenditure and stock returns, and examine the impact of R&D intensities on stock market metric of firm performance. The present study suggests that R&D expenditure should be treated as intangible assets rather than cost. Firms in developing countries give less attention to R&D activities due to uncertainty. In this respect, the government can play an important role by providing financial support to companies willing for innovative activities. Our findings have very important implications for investors and managers, as they misinterpret R&D investment as expenditure. Consequently, investors and managers should give importance to R&D expenditure as an intangible asset rather than cost. Thank you.
Harikumar sir, Harikumar sir,
hello Biju, hello Biju, Biju, hello. Hello, Biju.
Biju. Biju. Hello. Sir, we can hear you.
I think there is a sort of a technical difficulty at the side of our remote, sir.
Can I ask?
Yes, ma'am, please ask. Please ask.
Have you interviewed any R&D firms on what expenditures are actually incurred on everything was collected from secondary data? Should I repeat the question?
Hello?
Yes.
Now it is okay.
Bijo?
Yeah.
Hello? I think there is some echo.
So now it is over, sir. You can ask right now.
It's okay.
Yeah. It is all.
So Tariq Asish? Samina? Hello? Hello?
Samina Ghassal, are you there? Dr. Tariq Asish?
Samina Ghassal?
Hello? Hello, am I audible? Hello?
Yeah, audible.
Yeah.
You can respond.
English?
Samina?
Yes, sir.
I think you have applied different regression models here. Hello?
Yes. What's your question, sir?
You applied different regression models here.
Yes, sir. Firstly, I have tried to make portfolio, like my basic methodology is portfolio formation technique. After creating the portfolios, that is monthly portfolios, then I have went for regression, that is pharma French and using pharma French cohort factors, and on that basis
can you explain that factors?
Okay, basically, start with shall I explain the portfolio analysis methodology also?
Okay. Pharma, okay. French and coherent regression analysis. I think there is a separate equation for that.
Yes. This is the equation of Pharma, French and cohort. Can you see that?
Yes, I saw it.
Okay. This is basically the mix up of four factors. That is excess market return. That is and SMB. SMB actually are the growth factors. Growth factors are basically they tell that small market capitalization or caps on an average in long run. Actually, we are talking about short run and long run methodology. So in long run, they outperform the large market cap. And these are the four factors. And HML is basically the value factor. And WML, that is the momentum factor. That is the recent factors we use, like on the basis of 11-month period beginning from 12 month ago and 1 month. Ending 1 month ago.
I know. It's a very good application, but I have a doubt. Can you explain that equation? RPT minus R.
Let me explain. That is RPT minus RFT is basically words we can say it's a excess return that represent the additional return that was realized by foregoing the certain return associated with risk factor.
Then A plus B,
these are the basically the constant, and then the factors that
I
is
know, but okay. RMT minus RFT plus
equal to alpha plus beta. These are the factors I have taken, like portfolios, like P1
portfolio one I have taken once, then going to all the five factors, five portfolio, I have applied this regression analysis, and based on this I have found that the portfolio which is carrying the smallest value of R&D expenditure shows the lowest return as compared to the highest portfolio, and the difference is called as H minus L, as you can see here. And the result of this statistic is significant. This shows that it is creating a pattern, like from smallest to lowest, it is creating a pattern that from the small portfolio is giving small return and the highest portfolio is giving us highest return.
Okay, but it's a very good application. Very good application. I congratulate you for the application of this type of regression.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am, you can ask.
Thank you. Yeah, what I was asking is, this is purely on the secondary data, right? Any primary information or primary investigation is made for making this research paper?
No, ma'am, not yet. Actually, I'm working on, it's a work, my research topic is basically based on this, and I will be focusing on complete intangible index. So the I will be going for corporate culture and these kind of aspects for that qualitative basis, but not in R&D expenditure. As the data is available, the amount values are available in ProbeSIQ. So I have applied this only. That is
so
secondary
which
basis.
You have collected this information from which sources of secondary data?
ProbeSIQ, all the listed companies available there.
Okay. That's it from my side.
Okay, thank you.
So this second track comes to an end right now. I would like to thank the chairs, Professor Kinari Thakur from Mumbai University and Professor Hari Kumar from Kerala University Department of Commerce, and all the presenters who were presented in this track. So over to you, host.
Thank you, Biju. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you to Professor Dr. P. N. Hari Kumar and CMA Dr. Kinari V. Thakur. On a total, we had 11 papers presentation, and all of them looked into various aspects of banking and allied services. Both our chair have taken a great strain in going through the paper, listening to the presentation and giving valuable suggestions. Dr. P. N. Hari Kumar, Professor, Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, has always made it a point to attend all the programs hosted by the department. His suggestions has not only benefited today's paper presenters, but also for all the other participants during the presentation. On behalf of the department, we thank you, sir, for such an amazing chairing.
Next, we would like to thank CMA Dr. Kinari V. Thakur, the co-chair of this track. She has also spared her valuable time online all the way from Mumbai. Her suggestions to the presenters have been a great source of guidance and motivation for presenting more and more good papers. On behalf of the Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, we thank you, ma'am, for your esteemed presence and valuable suggestions.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Can I leave the meeting now?
Yes, we have right. You can leave.
Because your other track is done. Yes.
Next track. Professor Rajesh, Rasha ma'am and Dr. Bijuti is there.
Yeah.
Rasha ma'am is there.
Rasha madam, I have sent you a message already. Chat.
Right. Thank you for joining. Thank you so much. Just a wonderful session.
Thank you so much. Simon sir, I have sent you also a message.
Thank you so much, sir, for having me here.
We'll meet again, either online or offline. Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Sure, sir. We'll meet. Offline will be better, sir. Next year, in our conference also, I'll invite you and madam both for offline conferences.
Hopefully, we'll all see without mask and without...
That's true. That's true.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yes.
So, host, we can start the third track, track C. Please move forward.